When I returned to Havana in October of 1997, Cubans were lining the streets for the final burial of Che Guevara. Che had fought for our country in the 1959 revolution and was killed leading the guerrilla struggle in Bolivia in 1967. That year, as a young communist pioneer, I had already placed a flower before a bust of Che and pledged with my classmates, "Pioneers for communism, we will be like Che." I was born a year after the triumph of the revolution. In school, we were taught that communism was the best political system in the world. It would abolish the gap between rich and poor, end racial discrimination, aid those in need, and create a paradise on earth.
Que es un derecho inmemorial de los hombres.
Cantará la esperanza, quiere ser tu iglesia, quiere ser tus manos, quiere ser tu voz, quiere ser tu imagen.
In January of 1998, 3 months after Che's funeral, I watched Cubans again line the streets and public plazas to welcome another messenger of truth and hope. At this crossroad of the revolution and belief in God was my own journey, my own search for faith in Cuba. Four decades after the Cuban Revolution, I found Havana still a city under siege. The American economic and political blockade began when I was 2 years old in 1962, the longest embargo in modern history. The blockade has failed to bring down the government. Its most devastating impact has been on ordinary Cubans. Electricity, food, and clothing are rationed. Houses deteriorate and collapse from the tropical climate and lack of repair materials. There is a scarcity of oil and gasoline for transportation. It's difficult to get to work. The state has little money for new buses or other forms of modern transportation. Trade with Western countries is changing communism in Cuba. So is an increase in religious faith, which is beginning to transform the country. The government calls this time of even greater scarcity since the fall of the communist world the special period. I decided to film some of my old friends and neighbors to find out how their beliefs were changing during this special period. The Catholic Church has been a major force in Cuba's political life, in education, and aid for the poor and sick from the 1500s to the 1950s. Four decades of living under communism has left a large part of the population separated from their church. Creating the new communist human being after the 1959 revolution meant rejecting the religious and cultural beliefs of the past. My aunt and uncle attended Catholic schools in the 1950s. For me, there was no baptism or First Communion in the 1960s. The big events were birthdays, celebrated with family and friends. For my sisters, their 15th birthday marked the rite of passage into adulthood. This was the church my mother and father were married in the 1940s. My mother's family was Catholic. But my father's mother believed in Santeria. At their wedding, the two families and different faiths briefly came together. But my mother thought Santeria was superstition and witchcraft and forbade me visiting my father's family. She became an atheist in the 1970s after witnessing state persecution of Jehovah's Witnesses who refused to let their children enter the military. My own wedding, 20 years after the revolution, was a civil ceremony before a public notary. When Fidel Castro officially proclaimed Cuba a socialist country in 1961, religious institutions were closed and Christian and Afro-Cuban religious worship discouraged. From then on, the educational, physical, and material needs of the people would be provided by the communist state. Many Cubans still support the revolution because the government has won major achievements in literacy, education, health, and welfare. Out of a population of 11 million, 3 million Cubans attend high schools and universities. The University of Havana is the largest of 40 universities and colleges spread throughout the country. It graduates 5,000 students a year in all disciplines. Students pay no tuition and receive free housing, food, books, and living expenses from the government. In exchange, they are required to contribute 1 month of voluntary labor a year and 2 full years after graduation. Government support for the arts has also made Cuba a major cultural center in the Caribbean. Even poor families can send their children for education and training to the many cultural institutions funded by the state. The Garcia Lorca Theater is where I danced in the 1980s. Today, dance students still rehearse here for further advanced training at the National Art School and the Higher Institute of the Arts. They dream of professional careers with the many classical, contemporary, and folk dance companies existing in the country. Yet, some human need is still unanswered. Despite the government's efforts to provide for the people's physical, educational, and artistic needs, many still search for spiritual fulfillment. I often saw this search for spiritual self-expression in the visual and other arts. Art critic Lazara Castellano talks about spirituality and culture in her popular radio program Form, Light, and Color.
El cubano es un ser insular. Es un ser que vive aislado de otros lugares y que necesita mucho creer. Yo creo que en estos momentos, en finales del siglo, en lo que de alguna manera la utopía social ha sido puesta en duda, en lo que estamos llenos de innumerables dificultades que todos conocemos, en los que tenemos tantos enemigos poderosos alrededor nuestro, el pueblo, el común, necesita, en medio de sus propias dificultades vivenciales, contingenciales, en medio de su propia existencia tan difícil, necesita agarrarse de algo, agarrarse de alguna manera de algo o de alguien, y está creyendo en la religión, en Dios, lo que dice.
You can see a vivid example of this need to believe in the small town of Regla, on the other side of Havana Bay. Regla is a crossroads of Cuban cultural identity, a coming together of Christianity and Afro-Cuban religions. Its church contains a sanctuary of the miraculous Black Virgin of Regla, venerated by both Christians and followers of the Yoruba religion. Father Angel was the priest of the church from 1952 to 1995 and an important person in the town's community. He told me of his memories as a priest administering to his parishioners for over four decades.
En esos 42 años han sucedido tantas cosas, tantos recuerdos, tantas emociones, pero indiscutiblemente que tengo dos hechos como los más importantes. Primero, la coronación canónica de la imagen de la Virgen de Regla. Segundo, el rapto de la imagen de la Virgen de Regla por el movimiento 26 de julio con el fin de evitar la procesión y los consiguientes festejos populares.
Y líbranos del mal. Amén. ¿Conocen quién es la Virgen de la Caridad?
Because of the decline of the Catholic Church after the 1959 revolution, more people worship Afro-Cuban religions than Christian faiths. This santero, or priest, wears the blue and white colors of the Black Virgin of Regla, known as Jemaya in the Yoruba religion. He cleanses the souls of worshipers of bad spirits and influences. The faithful wash their bodies with holy water filled with perfume and white petals. The shaking of the maracas calls on the spirits and welcomes them to the ceremony. The ritual marks a new beginning and expresses the hope for spiritual and material well-being.
Los negros que vinieron en el siglo pasado, muchos de ellos adultos, traían su religión de allá, principalmente Yoruba. Entonces, naturalmente, no dejaban esa religión. Algunos se convirtieron al cristianismo, pero otros permanecieron fieles a esa su religión. A través del tiempo, pasó, ha llegado a nuestros días, aunque sin organización, un movimiento fuerte de personas que tienen esto que se llama sincretismo. La palabra sincretismo significa mezcla. Es mezcla de culto católico con culto yoruba.
Unlike Christian faiths, followers of Afro-Cuban religions worship in their homes rather than in public buildings.
Yo me amo a mi hija, pero entre mí hay un espíritu. Aquí en mi corazón hay un espíritu. En mi mente hay un espíritu. Mi alma es un espíritu. Cuando yo me muera, ese espíritu va al cielo. Ese espíritu se llama mi hija. Porque en sí, yo no muero. Paso a otra forma de vida, a otra fase de la vida.
The worship of African gods continued over four centuries of slavery in Cuba, beginning in the 1500s. This folk dancer is enacting the powerful god spirit, Elegua, protector of the home and leader to new paths in life.
Y ellos venían sin nada en la mano, venían solamente con su memoria. Y con su memoria ellos establecieron toda una estructura de cultura que hoy en día nosotros la vemos vivir entre nosotros. Porque esos mitos son mitos vivos. Esa fe existe todavía. Todavía podemos visitar muchas casas y vamos a ver nosotros que esos dioses todavía viven entre nosotros, viven en la tierra.
My friend Ophelia is a madrina, or godmother, in the Yoruba religion, called Santeria. Her house is an example of the syncretism of Cuban religions, the combined worship of African deities, Catholic saints, and spiritist beliefs.
Acá, arriba en la altura, está Dios, el Santísimo, el Dios supremo de todos nosotros, lo que practicamos la religión santoral, Lukumí, Yoruba. En el medio tengo la copa del Santísimo y distintas asistencias de copas y vasos de agua que son a los espíritus familiares. Y hacemos esto como símbolo de darle un apoyo espiritual, un levantamiento espiritual, una claridad.
Today, Ophelia is busy. As a madrina, she has specific responsibilities to spiritually guide her godchildren through life.
Yo soy la madrina de varios ahijados, como lo decía. Madrina significa ser la segunda madre de la persona que usted consagra en esta religión. Persona que uno debe querer mucho y admirar y respetar por tal papel que está representando, ¿no? Siempre hay una pauta a seguir y una línea a seguir. Uno como madrina debe estar a la vela de todo tipo de situación que pueda estar existiendo alrededor de la persona a quien uno ha consagrado, sea de salud o sea de cualquier tipo de índole. Para ello es como si fuera la representación del padre, de la madre. A falta de la madre y el padre está la madrina. Si lo tiene, no importa, es un apoyo más que tiene.
As in most countries, Cubans follow many religions and belief systems, often within the same family. Ophelia's son, Tony, has been a Rastafarian for many years. His mother is still coming to terms with Tony's Rasta culture.
Ser Rasta para mí es ser sobre todas las cosas natural, aceptar a la humanidad tal y como sea. Y sí sigo con el problema que creo que existe en el mundo entero, pero bueno, es mío. Y es todo el odio a las personas que toman actitudes represivas en contra de las personas que lo rodean. Rasta es unidad, paz y amor. Dios para mí es el poder mío de enfrentarme a la vida, ¿no? De ser natural, de ser yo. No sé, es que es lo único que te da, eso es lo único que te da posibilidad de creer en algo. De moverte dentro de la sociedad y darte valor a ti mismo y a las cosas que tú haces y las cosas que piensas. Para mí ese es Dios.
For many Cubans, faith in Fidel Castro's revolution is their strongest belief. Hector Gallo, a neighbor of my sister's in Alamar, fought in the Cuban Revolution and helped prepare Che Guevara's expedition to Bolivia. The neighborhood children are afraid of Gallo and his strange sculpture garden.
Ahora aquí están los asesinos del socialismo. Están aquí sepultados. Y los que a nombre del socialismo le hacen daño al socialismo, porque no hacen lo que el socialismo espera de ellos.
La palabra fe es muy linda. Y yo creo que es lo que nos distingue de los animales, tener fe en algo. Yo soy de origen, como la mayoría de los cubanos, de un mestizaje de religiones, es decir, cristiano. Yo estoy bautizado, confirmado, mis hijos están bautizados. Pero al mismo tiempo, esa fe en Cristo que era, pero tenía influencia al mismo tiempo de vecinos nuestros que tenían religiones africanas. Y yo veía que unos y otros ponían caras muy lindas cuando profesaban su fe. Y me gustaba mucho, pero cuando empiezo, por razones que no caben en este espacio, con 12 años me inicio en la vida laboral, me toca hacerlo junto a un hermano mío que ejerció una influencia decisiva. Él me hizo barbero y comunista. Yo no voy a hacer una definición de lo que significa el Che para todos los cubanos, pero yo me atrevo casi a asegurar que es el sentimiento de la inmensa mayoría de nuestro pueblo. Es un símbolo del hombre nuevo que él proclamó. Él proclamó un hombre nuevo donde sin renunciar a los intereses materiales predominaran los intereses espirituales. Y predicó con su ejemplo. O sea, que Che será un símbolo siempre de lucha, de fe, de esperanza y sobre todo de confianza ilimitada en el ser humano.
Si te preguntan cuando paso por la calle qué cosa soy y a qué me dedico, no tengas pena ni le sigas sin miedo. Esos chamacos la ponen de pico. Si te preguntan cuando paso por la calle.
For young people like Tony, born many years after the revolution, Hector Gallo's idealism is far removed from the realities of daily life.
Política no me interesa, pero la vida es una política. Vivir, solamente vivir es política.
Havana's Prado, leading to the presidential palace, once was one of the most beautiful avenues in the city. Today, young people come here to meet friends, drink, dance, and forget about their difficulties. Cuba's economic crisis of the 1990s has deepened a spiritual crisis of belief.
Imagínate una cosa así. Jinetera, jinetera, que te acuestas con cualquiera, te paras en la esquina buscando dinero a montón para comprar medicina, tu familia se muere de hambre, tú te tienes tremendo calambre, el bolsillo me tiembla. No tengo dinero, me quieres matar, pero con la policía te vas a enredar. Algo así.
The collapse of communism internationally, combined with the American blockade and Cuba's inability to provide for the economic needs of its people, has gradually destroyed the widespread idealism of the past. Armando Machado is 85 years old. He has worked as a communications engineer in the El Moro Citadel since 1934, guiding ships into the Havana harbor from all over the world.
Me golpea el bloqueo porque, por ejemplo, hoy en día yo no puedo ir a una tienda a comprar nada porque vaya, todo ya ha cambiado y entonces no tengo manera de comprar nada. Me golpea la comida porque antes venía esto, venía lo otro y ahora debido al bloqueo hay ciertas y determinadas cosas de que no vienen a Cuba. Y entonces figúrate, eso lo golpea uno.
Before 1991, I saw the Havana harbor filled with ships from the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe bringing billions in foreign aid and trade each year. This economic and political support suddenly disintegrated with the collapse of the communist governments. Manuel, a member of the Communist Party, is a naval mechanic. He spends more time at home now. Fewer ships are trading with other countries, so there is less work. Cuban wages are extremely low by Western standards. Manuel earns the equivalent of $15 in pesos a month. A small bonus in dollars allows him to buy a few items like soap, shampoo, and toothpaste at hard currency stores. All Cubans receive monthly government rations for subsidized food. But the food quotas rarely last until the end of the month. Manuel, like many Cubans, hasn't lost faith in the government despite the economic hardships. The state provides him with subsidized housing, free medical services, and education.
Realmente a mí no me preocupa el futuro de mi niña, ¿por qué? Porque aquí están creados los medios para que los niños crezcan sanos, fuertes y saludables. Ese es el primer término, que es lo fundamental de la salud. Lo demás viene solo. El dinero no hace falta prácticamente porque el interés empieza y acaba, como digo yo. Lo fundamental es tener salud, lo demás viene solo.
Marlem, Manuel's wife, struggles to keep house on his salary and that of her daughter, Kenya. She hopes for a better future, but has no active interest in religion.
Bueno, nunca me he dedicado a la religión como tal. No. He ido a la iglesia cuando he bautizado a mis hijos y eso, pero no, religión así como tal, no tengo ninguna.
Armando Machado also doesn't practice his religion, but he honors the memory of his dead wife, who never lost her faith.
Mi señora, que paz descanse, era muy católica, muy religiosa. Le gustaba mucho, pensaba mucho en Dios. Todos los días por la mañana, ella se paraba delante del retrato, pedía para todos nosotros suerte, salud y demás y eso. Entonces ese retrato para mí tiene un valor muy grande, porque inclusive a mí me lo han querido comprar y yo digo que mientras yo viva ese retrato no se lo lleva a nadie, porque es un recuerdo de mi señora.
En la forma de que lo han hecho ellos, yo estoy muy agradecido, pienso que tú lloras.
For many Cubans, U.S. dollars from relatives abroad or tourists are the only way of obtaining basic consumer goods. Deprived of freedom of speech, a free press, and free elections, many feel marginalized and powerless to shape their own destiny. I saw this crisis of belief in the increased worship of Saint Lazarus, the saint of atonement and martyrdom. Every December 17th, thousands make the pilgrimage to his sanctuary in Rincon. He is the most miraculous saint for the Cuban people.
Babalu, Babalu.
They offer their own suffering as a sacrifice to the saint to obtain his assistance. Some come to fulfill a past vow, or in a new supplication. Others ask to be healed. Mothers bring their children and pray for the saint's blessing for their health and future. Inside the sanctuary, worshippers light candles and ask Saint Lazarus to intercede with Christ so that they too, like Lazarus, may be healed. Lazarus is also a Yoruba divinity, known as Babaluwa-Je. Worshippers bring tobacco as an offering and burn cigars like incense in the honor of the saint. Since the mid-1990s, there's also been a substantial increase in church attendance. To arouse public enthusiasm for the Pope's visit in January of 1998, the Catholic Church organized a tour of the Virgen del Cobre to churches throughout the island. Lasting 100 days, this tour by the country's patron saint helped to accustom Cubans to manifest their faith in public. Until the arrival of John Paul II, these church visits were the largest demonstrations of religious fervor since the 1959 revolution. Witnessing these religious marches made me wonder whether Cuba was at a crossroads of its political life. Was the government prepared to give a greater voice to the Catholic Church and permit a public debate about the serious problems facing Cuban society? Other extraordinary events were the national broadcasts on radio and television of the Pope's visit and his four outdoor masses in different provinces of Cuba. Because of the Pope's strong opposition to the American blockade, the state-controlled media for the first time gave radio and television access to the Catholic Church to communicate directly with the people. One of the Pope's masses took place in Santiago de Cuba, the cradle of the revolution. The theme of this mass was the state of the nation. The opening speech by Archbishop Pedro Maris of Santiago was the strongest criticism of Cuba's political system heard in public in decades.
Quiero presentarle, Santo Padre, a este pueblo que me ha sido confiado. Este es un pueblo que ha luchado largos siglos por la justicia social y ahora se encuentra al final de una de esas etapas buscando otra vez cómo superar las desigualdades y la falta de participación. Santo Padre, deseo presentar en esta Eucaristía a todos aquellos cubanos y santiagueros que no encuentran sentido a sus vidas, que no han podido optar y desarrollar un proyecto de vida por causa de un camino de despersonalización que es fruto del paternalismo. Le presento además a un número creciente de cubanos que han confundido la patria con un partido, la nación con el proceso histórico que hemos vivido en las últimas décadas y la cultura con una ideología. Hay otra realidad que debo presentarle. La nación vive aquí y vive en la diáspora. El cubano sufre, vive, espera aquí. Y también sufre, vive y espera allá afuera.
After years of confrontation between church and state, Cuba now had a national patron saint, coronated by the Pope. For the first time in decades, a woman's name symbolized the belief and aspirations of our nation.
¡Viva! ¡Viva la Virgen!
¡Viva! ¡Viva nuestra madre y patrona!
The Pope's visit culminated in his final public mass in the Plaza of the Revolution, with Fidel Castro in the audience. This mass attracted thousands of Cubans who had never even been inside a church. But like myself, they'd come to hear the Pope's message of peace and reconciliation. They hoped for an improvement in the spiritual and political crisis affecting their lives. John Paul II spoke out strongly for freedom of expression and religious freedom.
Un Estado moderno no puede hacer del ateísmo o de la religión uno de sus ordenamientos políticos. El Estado, lejos de todo fanatismo o extremo secularismo, debe promover un sereno clima social y una legislación adecuada que permita a cada persona y a cada confesión religiosa vivir libremente su fe.
Hey. Entonces, vivir libremente su fe, expresarla en los ámbitos de la vida pública y contar con los medios y espacios suficientes para aportar a la vida nacional sus riquezas espirituales, morales y psíquicas. Cuba tiene un alma cristiana y eso la ha llevado a tener una vocación universal, llamada a vencer el aislamiento, a abrirse al mundo, y el mundo debe acercarse a Cuba, a su pueblo, a sus hijos.
efforts by the Catholic Church to normalize relations between Cuba and the rest of the world largely depend on what kind of support it receives from other countries. Deacon Donat Devats is the Canadian National Director of Aid to the Church in Need, an international Catholic aid organization. Its 17 donor countries around the world alone channel over $500,000 to the Cuban Church each year.
The greatest needs today for the Church in Cuba is certainly the rebuilding, the renovation, the reparations of churches. Some of these churches are in deplorable condition. In actual fact, in some places, you have to be told that a church used to be there. We have an opportunity here to rebuild the building, the church, as such.
After four decades of neglect, little remains of the many convents and seminaries that educated Catholics and trained priests and nuns before the revolution. This is the former convent of Belen, where young Catholics studied for the priesthood. The convent now is the site of an outdoor market. At his final mass in Havana, Pope John Paul II blessed the foundation stone for a new Catholic seminary, a symbol of hope and religious renewal. In 1998, there were still only 260 priests in Cuba to look after the island's almost 4 million Catholics. Father Gustavo Londoño has taught at the Seminary of San Carlos, which educates priests in Havana.
En el presente curso tenemos 85 seminaristas, 60 diocesanos procedentes de las 10 diócesis del país, de todos los rincones de Cuba, y 25 religiosos de las órdenes presentes actualmente en el país. Muchos de los seminaristas, hay que reconocerlo, han hecho ya alguna carrera profesional. Tenemos médicos, a ingenieros, agrónomos, economistas, pero que no se sentían satisfechos en la vida con esto. Y entonces dieron el salto en la fe, salto con mucho riesgo, pero que ahora quieren consagrar su vida a los hermanos.
Aid to the Church in Need provides financial support to operate the seminary and assist its students.
Los seminaristas vienen desprovistos de todo. El seminario debe darles no solamente la formación humana, la formación espiritual, la formación académica, sino también lo material. Sus familias son muy pobres y aquí hay que proveerlos de su vestuario, de sus útiles, de los implementos de limpieza, medicinas y por lo tanto su aporte generoso.
La gente está buscando a Dios. La gente está acudiendo a las iglesias. Hay gente que está cooperando en esa labor tan grande que es llevarle a esos niños que no conocen a Dios y que en la escuela le están diciendo que Dios no existe y que Dios es un invento de los hombres, llevarle aquel conocimiento para que no les pase como a mí, que a los 20 años fue que vine a saber de que Dios existía y que Dios era mi Padre Creador, para que esos niños también lo crean. Ahora más que nunca una ayuda fuerte, no solamente de dinero, mucha oración hace falta, solidaridad, saber uno que no estamos solos.
People of Cuba are hungry for spiritual food and have been for a long time. And finally, they get it from the Pope himself. We have in Cuba now distributed over 150,000 children's Bibles in their language. We have distributed over 150,000 catechisms, little catechisms. which are now being used to educate the people. We should not forget that they have been deprived of 40 years now of the Word of God. Yet in their heart, in their innermost being, they have always felt that there is something else than communism. What is for me like a miracle and the most amazing thing is that this re-evangelization of the Cuban people seems to take place from within the youth, the young people, who are now gathering in the church and take instructions in the faith and have a huge enthusiasm with which they go out into the country and bring the good news, the Word of God. And that fills you with tremendous hope for the future of the Cuban church.
Me voy a mostrar como una escéptica, no creo que él pueda torcer los rumbos al país, porque él no es el país. El país es el conjunto del pueblo y el conjunto de la nación es el que puede determinar qué camino, hacia dónde vamos todos. Si a un lado o a otro lado, si al éxito, si a la derrota, si al triunfo, no sabemos, ¿no? Pero yo creo realmente que el Papa no logra cambiar mucho.
Is Cuba becoming another country? The Pope's visit drew people to churches throughout Cuba and increased baptisms and church weddings.
Silvia, yo te bautizo en el nombre del Padre y del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo. Amén.
Cubans are returning to religious rituals that were part of their history for centuries. What was often carried out in secret after the revolution, once again is becoming a communal religious celebration. Witnessing these many baptisms and church weddings made me remember my own wedding and that of my parents. Cuba is becoming a more civic society through the louder voices of different faiths. At this historic crossroads, I felt that this search for faith and hope was taking us to a new belief in ourselves and in our nation.
En el período especial se pasa un período más caliente que el de fuego, porque presenta un mundo además cambiado en transformación y sin duda que esas transformaciones van a ser como un pacto duro, difícil, sangriento, pero con una criatura nueva que da lugar a una esperanza nueva que se vitaliza.
What I remember most about my visit to Cuba is what my friend Gayo said. Historically speaking, the hope is that the world will perfect itself. Even though there may be times when it appears the world is moving backwards, the world naturally advances. And we ourselves, as individuals, always become better, even though we often do not notice it. All human beings in the world can lack many things, but what they can never live without is hope.
civil escribir en la frente al oprobio subido, el clarín escuchar el sonido, a las armas valientes barrer.
¡Viva Jesucristo!
¡Viva!
¡Viva la Virgen de la Caridad del Cobre!
¡Viva!
¡Viva la Iglesia!
¡Viva!
¡Viva el Cobre!